First of all, let me thank the organizers and especially Stefano for inviting me here to this interesting conference in this very prestigious place. Well, my talk will be about a new system of canonical coordinates for the planetary problem, and if I have time to present some applications of it. And since I guess that many people here maybe not be familiar with the problem, I shall spend more or less one half, maybe three quarters of my talk also in describing the background. And in particular, I shall describe why it is important and even necessary for the planetary problem to look at different system coordinates, or sometimes it can be also or necessary or also useful in order to find, for example, for this problem, coexistence of stable or unstable motions. I shall talk about applications above all concerning perturbation theory to the planetary problem, but I shall be very quick on describing the perturbation theory that is behind this problem. Not because it is trivial, it is not trivial at all, because the problem is highly degenerate and perturbation theory is really interesting. The arguments are similar to the one that Bassam talked in the previous talk, but also these arguments, as Bassam explained, are very technical, and I shall concentrate above all on the geometric part on the problem, so that maybe at some extent may be considered as the new part, the more original part. So let's begin with the beginning. The planetary problem is a subproblem of the embodied problem. The embodied problem consists in determining the motions of a certain number, a finite number of masses that interact only through gravity. The system is Hamiltonian, is conservative, there is an Hamiltonian, such that its Hamilton equation governs the motion, its motions. The planetary problem is when one of the masses that we denote as M0 is much larger than the other. So we have one sun and N planets. The masses of the planets are very small compared to the one of the sun, and their smallness is ruled by a parameter that here is called with mu. The V will denote the positions of the planets, and the U, their conjugated momenta. With the 1 plus n particles, we shall have a system with the 3 plus 3n degrees of freedom, because we have 3 degrees of freedom for each particle. The standard, the symplectic form is the standard one. The problem has many symmetries, and the first of them, or maybe the simplest to be eliminated, is the symmetry by translations. There are many ways to eliminate this symmetry from the in a Hamiltonian way, and the one that I have written here is usually called the heliocentric reduction. This consists into the invariance by rotation is caused by the fact that, for example, the motion of the center of mass of the system is known. So it is possible to switch to a new Hamiltonian that governs just the motion of the planets. We have here new coordinates, the Y and the X, that are rescaled coordinates for the heliocentric relative positions of the planets. And precisely Ci times Ci will be the heliocentric position of each planet, where C and the Yi over Ci are their conjugated momenta. The Y and the X are some rescaled coordinates that I have introduced here in order to have simple formulas in the following. The Hamiltonian splits in two parts, a leading part that represents the interaction of each planet with a fixed star in the origin of the system of coordinates, and a small perturbation that is of strength mu that represents the interaction between one planet and one another. The C and the B are just constants that depend only on the masses and are of order one with respect to mu. The symplectic form is analogous to the previous one, but has just 3n degrees of freedom instead of 3n. After the reduction of translation, the system has still other symmetries that are important for its symplectic description, and this is in the invariance by rotations and by reflections. The invariance by rotations means that we can change all the Y and all the X by the same rotation matrix, and we shall have the Hamiltonian to be preserved. And it is also possible to change all the Y by some rotation and all the X by another rotation to have the Hamiltonian preserved, but this factor will not be used here. The invariance by rotation is ruled by the existence of three independent integrals. These are the three components of the total angular momentum of the planets. They are three independent integrals, but they do not commute. So we should expect that the number of degrees of freedom can be furtherly reduced, but not by three units because the three integrals do not commute. We shall see that it is possible to reduce the number of degrees of freedom at most by two other units. Then there is the invariance by reflections. We change the signs of all the Y, of all the X, or both of the components of those in the same way. We shall have the Hamiltonian still preserved. Let us look at the integrable part. The integrable part is this expression. When all the unperturbed energies are negative, as we all know, the motion evolves on Keplerian ellipses. The energy levels are compact, and using the method by Jacobi, it is possible to introduce, by the theorem by Liouville, Arnold, and Jost, a new set of classical coordinates that are action angle coordinates, such that each of these unperturbed energies is just a function of only actions. But here appears the first of the degeneracies of the problem. While at the beginning we have each of these Hamiltonians has 3 degrees of freedom, after the integration, the new Hamiltonian will have just 1 degree of freedom. There is just one only action coordinate in this expression that corresponds to be the square root of the semi-major axis of the ellipse. And so the integrable part of the whole system will have just n action coordinates instead of 3n. And this represents a problem if we want to apply KN theory to the planetary problem when we regard it as a perturbed problem. It looks like if here the integrable part does not depend on all the I, but only on a part of them. And so this fact is due, as it is well known, to the fact that the two-body problem has too many integrals. It's super integrable. And if the canonical elliptic elements after the Jacobi methods are usually called the Delaunay coordinates. And besides the action L, capital L, the remaining five elements are represented in this picture. The small L is conjugated to the capital L, and this is an angle that is proportional to the area that is spanned on the ellipse. Then there are two actions and two angles that are here denoted as capital theta, capital G, small theta, and small g. The two angles G, the theta is the longitude of the line that is the intersection of the plane of the orbit with the prefixed plane. This is defined when the inclination of this plane with respect to the prefixed plane is not zero. And the small g denotes the argument of the perihelion of the ellipse. And this is defined when this ellipse has an eccentricity different from zero, when this is not a circle. The two actions, g and theta, are two components of the angular momentum of the single planet. The capital theta is the third component, while the g is its Euclidean length. So we all are used to the fact that after integration, all the angles disappear from the Hamiltonian, but we are not used to the fact that also the action disappear. And here, in the two-body problem, this is a remarkable fact that happens because also the two angles that are conjugated to those two actions, they also are integrals in the unperturbed problem, but they will be not integrals, of course, in the whole problem. The Delaunay coordinates are canonical coordinates for each planet, so if we collect them all together, we shall have a system of coordinates for the whole system. At the end of the 19th century, Henri Poincaré introduced a new set of coordinates named after him, that in order to describe motions when the eccentricities may vanish or also the inclinations may vanish. Those configurations are singular for the Delaunay coordinates. This is the definition. Instead of the of the coordinates theta and g, here we have new coordinates p and q. They are not action angle, but they are rectangular coordinates and are defined in a ball around the origin. When the first couple of P and Q vanish, this corresponds to the vanishing of the eccentricity. When the second couple of P and Q vanish, this corresponds to the vanishing of the inclination. The coordinates are again canonical, and the remarkable fact is that the transformation from Poincaré coordinates to, for example, the Y and the X is smooth. It is even analytical. Analytic, sorry. The importance of Poincaré coordinates is here that if we consider the average of the perturbing function with respect to the angle L, italics L, these L are more or less the same as the mean anomalies, those L here. They are, those L here just shifted by a constant. Sorry. If we consider this average, this is the average in the sense of Lagrange, or from the point of view of dynamical system, is a sort of time average. By the symmetries of the systems, by rotations and refraction, what happens is that the origin, so the configuration with all the motions on circles in a single plane, this point is an elliptic equilibrium point for the averaged Hamiltonian. So having an elliptic equilibrium point, the very natural attempt would be to try to construct a Birkhoff normal form for the averaged system. So having an overall system with the integrable part that depends just on one part of the action. But the perturbing function having an average may be in a Birkhoff normal form of some order. Arnold, in the 70s, formulated an abstract theorem where that if applied to the Hamiltonian of the planetary problem, might lead to state the existence of quasi-periodic motions for the majority for the majority of initial conditions, for a set of initial conditions having a positive Lebesgue measure, at least if we are in a zone of the phase space where the eccentricities and the inclinations are sufficiently small. So in a smaller region around the elliptic equilibrium point of the system. The proof of this theorem took more difficult than expected, because in fact Arnold proved it in 63 just for the first non-trivial case, the planar three-body problem, using just Poincaré coordinates. And the difficulty of the expression to the other cases was caused by the strong degeneracies of the problem. The problem for the the theorem for the spatial three-body problem was proved just 30 years later by Lascar and Robutel, and they used a new system of coordinates in order to bypass the degeneracies. The theorem was completely proved by Herman and Feijoz in 2004, but they used abstract arguments in order to reduce the degeneracies. Their proof is indirect. And finally, in 2011, in a joint work with Luigi Cherchia, we proved the theorem, finding a new system of coordinates that allowed to overcome all the degeneracies of the problem, and we also obtained a sharp estimate on the measure of the invariant set. The Arnold theory that is used by Arnold, Roscalli, Robutel, and Luigi and myself is basically settled out by Arnold in the 60s, and it requires the following: that the average the system is in Birkhoff normal form up to the order 2, and that the matrix of the second order term is non-singular. This condition could be applied directly to the system by us. The theory that was applied by Herman and Feijoz is weaker, and also Bassam talked about it, and it requires non-planarity for the frequency map, and it just looks only the first order Birkhoff invariants, the coefficients here in the first order of the expansion and not the second one. It is a weaker KN theory, but it cannot be applied to the theorem directly because of the degeneracies of the problem. What are the degeneracies of the problem? In general, Birkhoff normal form, the construction of Birkhoff normal form requires a condition of no resonances on the frequencies of, on the first order terms on the frequencies of sigma 1. While for the planetary problem, these non-resonance conditions are not verified. There are two resonances that are verified identically for any value of DL. The first one was known to Arnold, and he knew that this is due to the invariance of the problem by rotation. And the second one has been noticed in its full generalities by Michel Herman in the 90s. And this prevents, these two identities prevents the construction of Birkhoff normal form, and also they prevent to check Herman's condition. Herman's condition is not very, this is just the contrary. Herman's condition is not verified. The rotational degeneracy is even worse than that, because if we look at the coefficients at any order of the Birkhoff normal form, even formally, if we try to construct it formally, we discover that all those coefficients, when one of the indices is equal to 2n, vanish identically. For example, if we look at the torsion, we shall have one row and one column identically vanishing, and the determinant would be different from zero. So this violates Arnold conditions. The idea is that the proper degeneracy of the problem allows for more freedom in the choice of coordinates, because the Keplerian ellipse is an object that we can regard as described as by four quantities. The 2L that we want to remain fixed, not to change and perturb the part of the problem, and then the angular momentum of each planet and its perihelion. The angular momentum has three independent components. The perihelion is to be perpendicular to the angular momentum. This is the perihelion direction, so its Euclidean length equal to 1. It's just introduced one other quantity, independent quantity. So we have four independent quantities that have to be described. And all what we need is just a system of coordinates that here I denote as L, L, Y, and X, where the capital and small L are just what I said before, while the Y and the X are two uncoupled of coordinates that are needed to describe the planet's perihelion and their angular momenta. And moreover, we require that the system of coordinates is canonical. This means that the standard two form is preserved. System of coordinates of these are the Delaunayan Poincaré coordinates, as I told about. They are widely used in the literature. Their application is countless in celestial mechanics. And for the two-body problem in the 19th century, there is another system of coordinates that was developed by Jacobi and Radot that reduced the number of degrees of freedom by 2 units. They reduced completely the invariance by rotations. But since they are available just for 2 planets, but since they are coordinates not on the whole phase space, but just on a manifold, on a lower dimensional manifold on the phase space, for more than one century, it has been very difficult to extend this coordinate to the case of more than 2 planets. And this is the heart of the difficulty of the extension of Arnold's theorem to the case of more than 2 planets. Another system of coordinates that has been quite forgotten for many years is a system of coordinates by Boisier and Depree. They were developed in the 80s by François Boisier for 3 planets and André Depree in general. Their application up to nowadays are unknown. The only application that are known to me are by two Spanish researchers, in the case n equal to 2. But in that case, the coordinates by Depree and Boisier coincide with the one of Jacobi and Radot. So they are not, this case is not really exhaustive. These coordinates by Boisier and Depree were worked out even about 10 years previously to the work by Hermann on the planetary problem, and to the result by Hermann 20 years before the result by Hermann and Fejose. And they were, by fortune, rediscovered by myself during my PhD while I was working to the theorem, to the Arnold's theorem. And starting with them, it is possible to produce a new system of coordinates that, with my advisor Luigi Chiertia, we call it the RPS, regular, planetary, and symplectic, that are analogous to Poincaré coordinates, but allow, as an advantage with respect to Poincaré coordinates, allow to bypass the degeneracies of the problem, and so allow for a direct proof of Arnold's theorem. The last system of coordinates that is of this year is what I call the perihelia reduction that gives the title to my talk. Just a quick look to how the Bouguer and the P coordinates, they are action angle coordinates that are denoted as L gamma psi, small l, small gamma, small psi. The two L are the same as before. The gammas are more or less the same as the Delaunay coordinates. The most important coordinates are the two psi. They are very different from the theta of the Delaunay. And above all, there are two couples that are very important. Those are two couples of coordinates such that the two angles, capital Z, small z and small g, are both cyclic into the Hamiltonian, and also the capital Z is a cyclic coordinate. So here we have three cyclic coordinates, and the number of degrees of freedom is so lowered by 2 units. They work in the following way. We consider the angular momentum of each planet and the so-called the partial angular momenta, Sj. These are the sums from 1 to j of the Ci. The Sn, the total angular momentum, is an integral. The three components of it are all integrals of the system. The first step is to put the system in the so-called invariable frame. This is the frame with the third axis in the direction of the total angular momentum. There are two coordinates, the capital Z and small z, that describe this rotation. The capital Z is the third component of the total angular momentum. The small z is the longitude of the plane by some reason shifted by pi over 2, by some historical reason, is the longitude of the plane that passes through the third axis of a prefixed free system and the total angular momentum. Those two quantities are two conjugated coordinates, and they also are integrals. They do not move, so they both disappear from the Hamiltonian. The disappearance of these two conjugated coordinates is just the origin of the degeneracy by rotation that I mentioned at the beginning, the vanishing of one of the first order eigenvalues of the torsion, and so on. Then here we consider the total angular momentum of the system, the sum of the first n minus 1 and the last 1, and the triangle. The plane that passes through this triangle is its position in this frame is ruled by the angle small g that is again a cyclic angle because it is conjugated to the capital G that is the Euclidean length of the angular momentum. So neglecting the small g would correspond geometrically to fix a system of coordinates that rotates around the angular momentum. And when n is equal to 2, here we are just in the situation of the Jacobi reduction of the nodes. But the power of the pre-coordinates is that this construction can be iterated. In this case, we introduce some new coordinates, the psi and the small psi. The pre-coordinates are not defined when the inclinations are equal to 0, or also, as in the case of Delaunay, when the ellipses are circles, when the eccentricities are zero, because when the inclinations are equal to zero, the S and the C are parallel one to the other, and those angles are not defined. So in order to regularize these coordinates, I introduced a new system of coordinates, the top Poincaré light. They are even denoted with the same letters. And the advantage is that two couples of coordinates are cyclic. They disappear into the Hamiltonian, and the degeneracy by rotation is so removed. With the system of coordinates, the system has 3n minus 1 degrees of freedom, not 3n minus 2. There is an extra degrees of freedom that is the price that we pay due to the fact that we want to regularize all vanishing eccentricity and inclination. This leads to the complete proof of Arnold's theorem, because now the averaged perturbing function can be put in Birkhoff normal form, and the Birkhoff normal form has a non-trivial twist. What are the remarks? These coordinates are not defined when the problem is planar, and this is very relevant. The planar problem is very relevant for physics because all the planets in our solar system have eccentricities almost vanishing and inclinations almost vanishing. There are not parities associated in general to the symmetry by reflection, except in the fact n equal to 2, where there are symmetries. And these coordinates are not defined as I say the RPS coordinates are defined for the planar problem, but as I said before, there is just an extra degrees of freedom. Another question concerning Arnold's theorem is that with applying Arnold's theorem, we prove the existence of full measure in the sense of Lebesgue, of an almost full measure in the sense of Lebesgue, of quasi-periodic motions for the problem around the elliptic equilibrium point. This means, from the physical point of view, that we have to take motions closer and closer to circle on a plane in order to find more and more preserved tori. And we could ask what happens in the remaining regions of phase space. Are there quasi-periodic motions? And which is their measure? With the theorem by Arnold, the measure goes to zero with eccentricities and inclination. Is it possible to prove existence of quasi-periodic motion with a measure that goes to one with the eccentricities and inclination? And the result is that if we fix two arbitrary values of the eccentricity up to this threshold value, and if we choose the semi-major axis separated in this way, and the mass is really smaller with respect to the smaller of this one, it is positive to find a positive measure set of 3n minus 2 dimensional quasi-periodic motions in the problem, the measure of which goes to 1 with respect to the separation among the semi-axis. And I am particularly proud of this result. Such set tends to the corresponding set of the planar problem when the inclinations go to 0. With the previous set of coordinates, it is not possible to prove this one because, as I said before, those coordinates are singular when the eccentricity is equal to 0. A related result has been announced by Jacques Fejoz since 2013. The new system of coordinates I want to present is based on the partial angular momenta, as in the case of the pre, and instead of the angular momenta of the single planets, on the perihelia. And this is why I call it perihelia reduction. We consider these chains of vectors. The first is the third axis of a fixed frame, the total angular momentum, the last of the perihelia, the last but one partial angular momentum, the perihelia Pn minus 1, until we arrive to S1 and P1. Each ring of this chain is regarded as a third axis of a prefixed frame in the configuration space. The first step is the same as in the pre-coordinates. We change a frame in order to overlap our initial frame to the invariable frame with the third axis parallel to the total angular momentum. And the other two pieces of this chain are represented by this picture. In this picture, we have the third axis parallel to Si. When I is equal to n, this is the total angular momentum of the system. The first axis is basically arbitrary because the initial frame is arbitrary. Then we consider the last of the perihelia with I equal to n, the plane that passes through these two vectors. Its longitude is an angle phi I, And the Euclidean length of Si is the action phi psi I. When I is equal to n, this action is an integral and this angle is cyclic. So with this system of coordinate, we fix the motion of the horizontal projection of the last of the angular momenta. When the planetary problem, we fix the motion of the last, of the last of the perihelia. When the planetary problem, we fix the motion of the last of the perihelia. Then we switch to a system that has pi as the third axis, and this line, and I minus 1, that is perpendicular to the plane through as I and pi, as the first axis, and here we consider as I minus 1. Its third component is the action capital theta, and its longitude is the angle small theta. Those coordinates are singular when as I minus 1 is parallel to pi or pi is parallel to si, but this configuration has quite not physical meaning. So that it is simply we can exclude it from the phase space in order to describe the system. These coordinates are defined also in the planar problem, because in the planar problem Si and pi I are perpendicular one to the other, and the capital theta is equal to zero, and it is easy to see that the small theta is equal to pi. The advantage, there is another advantage, there is an involution that is associated to reflection symmetries. If we change the two theta, capital theta and small theta by the sign, we have a symmetry into the Hamiltonian. This does into the whole Hamiltonian, not only the average, the one. And this involution generates the existence of two n to the minus one planar equilibria. That corresponds, and this equilibrium corresponds to planar configuration with the different choices of the signs of the partial angular momenta. And the tori of the theorem 1 are obtained as bifurcating from the equilibrium with all the s parallel one to the other. Of course, one could study also the other equilibria. The next challenge will be to prove the coexistence of stable and unstable motion in the planetary problem. This is a result by Jeffries and Moser in 1963. They proved the existence of a three-dimensional Cantor family of hyperbolic tori in the system, provided the planet's eccentricities are small and the mutual inclinations between the two planets is sufficiently large. Satisfies this relation. This tori disappear for small inclination because for small inclination a suitable hyperbolic feature of the system bifurcates to be elliptic. And so this unstable tori disappear. But using my new coordinates, I can prove that when the inclination is small, a hyperbolic tori, three-dimensional hyperbolic tori, really still exists, provided the mutual inclination is small, the two planets revolve in opposite verses, one with respect to the other, and suitable relation between the angular momenta and the semi-major axes are satisfied. In this region of the phase space, I forgot to mention, Lascar-Robutel proved the existence of full-dimensional Kolmogorov tori, 1995, and Biasco, Kierkia, and Valdinoci proved the existence of two-dimensional elliptic tori. So, with the theorem that is still a work in progress, I proved the coexistence of stable and unstable motion for the planetary problem. And the last result that I want to mention, is also work in progress, is that in the case of the free body problem, all the motions where no mean motion resonances are resonances for the leading part, for the that occur only for the Keplerian frequencies. And if the eccentricity of the inner planets is sufficiently small, are stable in the sense of Nekrashov. Nekrashov in 77 proves stability only for the actions that are related to the semi-major axes. With this theorem, I prove, and the result was later improved by Hermann in 1996. With this result, I proved the stability for all the actions of the problem, and in particular for the eccentricities and inclination. And this may have some consequence that goes in a very asymptotic point of view in the direction of the proof of the stability. Is a small result that goes in the direction of the proof of the stability of the solar system. What are the main, I have no time to explain the proof, but just to give a rough idea. In the case of the two-body problem, the Hamiltonian that is obtained using the Jacobi and Radot coordinates is here. It is, for some reason, it is integrable. It depends by just one angle, the angle G1, and it's represented here. If we switch to Poincaré coordinates, we shall have an Hamiltonian, a series in terms of eccentricity coordinates. While using my new coordinates, I have an analog expression that still depends by just one angle. But it is now a series in the inclination coordinates. And the advantage is that the point with the capital theta equal to zero and the small theta equal to zero to pi are equilibria. So we can integrate this part by constructing a convergent Birkhoff normal form associated to it. When the number of planets is more than two, it is possible to apply a procedure of integration mixed with the overaging planet by planet, and this leads to the proof of theorem 1. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you.